Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And on this episode, we'll be discussing Through Imperial Eyes from Season 3 of Rebels. But before we get to that, Jay, if you could do the honors and remind everybody where we can be found around social media.
It is an honor indeed, Dennis. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right, this is aligned. The signal is boosted to maximum output. The shield is down, and we are now broadcasting to the galaxy. This is our discussion of Through Imperial Eyes, which is episode 17 of season 3 of Rebels. This is going to be a full spoiler discussion. Jay, if you go ahead and give us our high-level summary of the episode.
Absolutely. Here we go. When the Rebels learn that Fulcrum's transmission may have been traced, Ezra Bridger goes undercover as a bounty hunter that is captured departing Lothal. In his cell, Ezra informs Agent Kallus that they are planning to extract him, but Kallus informs Ezra that Grand Admiral Thrawn is closing in on the location of their secret base. Before they can formulate any plans, Kallus' cruiser has a rendezvous with Thrawn's Star Destroyer. Thrawn informs Kallus, Colonel Yularen, and other Imperial officers that they have a spy among their ranks, and Yularen is there to help investigate. Kallus skillfully implicates an Imperial lieutenant while helping Ezra escape. Once the escape is complete, Thrawn pulls Yularen into his confidence. Neither believe the accused officer is capable of what he was charged with. Furthermore, Thrawn concludes that Kallus is Fulcrum and they will use him against the rebels in this capacity.
Right. So this is kind of building on the storyline that we've had going on this season where occasionally Kallus pops up. And he's been playing this role with Fulcrum. And so we're getting closer and closer to him getting caught and having to make a break. What do you think about this episode overall?
Again, this is one of those episodes that I remember the overall, but not the details. And it was a lot of fun to revisit, you know, getting to see Thrawn at his physical best, I guess you could say, against the droids, and getting to see some of the fun that goes along with trying to pull the wool over the eyes of some of these Imperial officers and whatnot. But it was also cool to see the level of skill that the officers had and in their physical prowess and that kind of thing. And just kind of seeing it from, as the episode mentions, you know, through Imperial eyes. And I love the way that this started, you know, with seeing, I think it's the first and only time we've ever seen a sink.
Yeah.
And a Star Destroyer kind of a thing. But yeah, it was a good episode, and it did kind of leave you wondering, especially if it's the first time you've ever seen it, you know, ooh, how's this going to go from here, and how is Thrawn going to use this information? But what about you?
No, it was a good episode. You know, you're mentioning, you know, as it starts off with that first person point of view from Agent Kallus. And if you go into the Rebels Recon on the website, it talks about how they originally had planned on doing the entire episode that way, but then they realized that they didn't really have the resources to make that work, and they couldn't devote the time to do it, so they ended up going back to the traditional angles for the rest of the episode after that opening scene. But it's a good episode. I think it's really, you know, fantastic. There really aren't that many subpar episodes this season. The first two seasons were good, and we tend to rave about all of them. But season 3 is just a tour de force when it comes to the show, with the storytelling on a weekly basis that they've been able to come up with, and how expertly they laid out their plot lines for the season. So a lot of things are getting ready to come to a head, and let's get into some more of the details. So we have this extraction plan that starts off with Ezra intentionally getting captured and posing as a bounty hunter, and he gets thrown into the cell. And of course, Kallus goes in there and tells the stormtroopers to leave them. He's going to conduct this interrogation himself. What did you think about the extraction plan?
Well, I guess if it wasn't for the fact that they ended up being in Thrawn's company, it wasn't a horrible plan. You know, I think that it was, I don't know if it was a good idea to have Ezra go in, you know, undercover. And obviously with his Jedi skills, he could have pulled some more things off than not just from trying to hide those kinds of skills. But, you know, in the end, one of the things that gave him away was the painting on his helmet being by Sabine. Mm-hmm. But, you know, of course, like I said, he would never have known that going in, that this would have necessarily happened. But I thought it was kind of cute the way that, you know, he was talking to Kallus and he said, no, we're here to get you out. You know, almost like he was so proud of this plan. And now is the time, and we're going to do this. But I mean, I guess I didn't dislike the plan, but I mean, overall, those are my thoughts. But what did you think?
Well, yeah, I mean, it made sense that they had to do something in person because they were afraid that the Empire had just traced Fulcrum's last communication. So if they have any more communications with him, it could lead the Empire right to him. And he's an asset, and he's provided some valuable intel. So it is worth trying to get him out of there, especially a guy like Kallus with all of his experience. He's very much someone who could be of use to the Rebellion. So I liked it overall, but I do just kind of enjoy the fact that we've seen Chopper infiltrate the Empire all the time with a fresh coat of paint from Sabine. I'm a little curious where he got the coat of paint this time, because
yeah, that's right.
Sabine's still with the Mandalorians on Cronus, mm-hmm. but maybe she taught somebody else. I don't know. Doesn't really matter. But AP5, who just really isn't doing that much to be inconspicuous.
No.
Mission. He's basically his cantankerous self this entire time. Now, it kind of goes back to one of these things that we hear 3PO say, that, you know, no one ever notices the droids. And that came up a lot in the comics. They're true. It's like the kitchen sink or the dishwasher or whatever. They're just appliances and they're around and you don't pay particular attention to them unless they're in your way. But still, I appreciate the AP5 and Chopper dynamic, and it was on display again in this episode, which is a lot of fun. And of course, AP5, they're just kind of subtly putting everybody down as they went.
I adore that. Can I just say?
Yeah. So we get the return of Yularen in this episode. Of course, we know him as Admiral Yularen from the Clone Wars, but now we have an older gentleman with white hair who is now serving as an ISB officer. And furthermore, he trained Agent Kallus. So yeah. What'd you think about his return?
Well, just hearing his voice, you know, brings back all the Clone Wars feels, first of all. But
yeah.
But yeah, I know when I was seeing him, I was like, oh, but Yularen, why are you working for the Empire? But I just think the whole ISB thing is awesome. I really do. And we get a lot of that even in the Aftermath trilogy, and just explaining how incredibly brutal these ISB agents are. So, you know, in some ways, it's kind of almost, for me, a jump in character to think that here he was, you know, on one side, and then now he's working for the Empire kind of thing. But I like him. I think he's awesome. And I think it was so much fun to see. And he's super smart, you know, just mm-hmm. working with Thrawn and the way that he was communicating with Thrawn in terms of what was going on and who was the spy and how could this be infiltrated this way. And I kind of wonder if Yularen had a little bit more of an inkling that List wasn't part of the actual, you know, spy thing either. Like, he's smarter than that kind of a thing. But
yeah,
but I'm rambling. But what do you think?
Well, he does say at the end of the episode that he doesn't really think, you know, he says to Thrawn, he didn't really think that List was capable of the things that Kallus was charging him with. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Thrawn agreed. And then he dives into his description of the evidence of why that may be, but we'll get to that in just a bit. Now, it was good to see Yularen back. It was a nice nod to the Clone Wars. It was, of course, in the Rebels recon on the website, it talks about how this character was originally reverse engineered from an officer sitting at that conference table on the Death Star from A New Hope. And, you know, they created a younger version of this man for the Clone Wars knowing that, you know, this was the guy. And that just was incredible foresight. And then having the opportunity to bring him back into to Star Wars with Rebels was a pretty cool idea. So it was good to see him back again.
Oh, for sure.
So, yeah. So we got, you know, the gig is up and Kallus knows that he's being suspected. Furthermore, they're now on Thrawn's Star Destroyer and they got to get off. And so Kallus has been in the meeting. He's heard that there's a suspected spy and he goes about setting up lists. What did you think about his plans and the way he moved around the Star Destroyer and framed lists for all these things?
Well, I just think it was pretty cool. And I've always wondered, I mean, now we know a lot more just from having a lot of different information and experience with it. But I always remembered thinking, what the heck are those things in their pockets? Like, I always thought they looked like spark plugs, you know? Yeah. And so I thought it was really ingenious the way that they kind of explained how these little cylinders are basically like little thumb drives in a way that are coded to each individual officer that gets them into various places. And then everything is recorded onto their cylinders. And so that's how they can tell, you know, who's who and where's what. And so they had the red and the blue. And so when he was switching them out and, you know, almost like pickpocketing him and doing these things, I was like, oh, Kallus, you're smooth, dude. You know, like, that this is pretty cool, which I guess goes along with being an agent, because you do have to be a little bit more underhanded, perhaps, when you're trying to get down to the bottom of information and doing some kinds of detective work and whatnot. But I just really appreciated the whole cylinder thing, I guess. And that just, like I said, takes me back to the spark plug days.
Right.
Kind of silly, indeed. but there you go.
Yeah, I really appreciated how devious Kallus got to be there. And, you know, he even planted the idea in Liss's mind that Governor Price, who was around, was the traitor, the spy. And then it, of course, worked out perfectly that she happened to be in the hangar there at the end when Ezra and the droids and Kanan and Rex were making their break for it. And so he attacks her, which frames himself even more. And so it a little bit of luck there, but an awful lot of skill on Kallus's part. And, you know, he just calmly moves about the ship, setting things up. And, you know, he gets into Thrawn's office and, you know, they find the information they need. And, of course, there was this whole notion that Thrawn was getting closer and closer to discovering which planet Phoenix Squadron had their base on. And so Chopper deleted that planet and put a different one in its place, which was a smooth move. Well, we'll see the consequences of that in an upcoming episode as well. But overall, I thought this was very clever the way they plotted these things out. Let's talk about Thrawn a little bit, because, you know, you brought up the physical prowess of some of these officers. But good Lord, Thrawn was just taking it to those, they're calling them assassin droids, but that's what were the dark troopers in The Mandalorian, and he was going hand to hand with these things.
Yep, he sure was. And this actually brings me to the Thrawn novels in a way. There was a scene in one of the novels where he was doing this combat scene. And so I guess it's reconciling in some ways. You know, we've talked before about the Thrawn in Rebels versus the Thrawn in the books. So I guess this is somewhat consistent with that. And it makes sense because, you know, not only is he strong of mind and fortitude of spirit, but he's also got to be strong in body. So I almost wonder if this is his way of getting those aggressions out so he can be so calm and cool and calculating when he's talking about everything else, that he just goes at it with these quote-unquote assassin droids and kind of gets it all out of his system. But he's pretty buff. And yeah, I mean, he's kicking them around. And I mean, Obi-Wan Kenobi tried to kick Grievous in the leg, and he was not any better for it. But yeah, Thrawn was going at it. And but then he was right back into his dress. And even my husband said, "Ooh, isn't he going to take a shower?" Yeah. I mean, that's a little thing, but yeah, I mean, it was pretty impressive. But what do you think?
Well, it was interesting. I had mixed feelings on it, simply because when you think to the end of season 2 of The Mandalorian and how Din Djarin, Bo-Katan, and Fennec Shand, you know, that whole crew were having trouble and were deathly afraid of the Dark Troopers breaking into that bridge, that they were just going to get slaughtered. Now, granted, there was more of them, more of the droids, that is, but there was also more of them. And they were, mm-hmm. you know, some of them were wearing Beskar. And so it just, it's one of those things where retroactively, this seems slightly implausible based on what we saw at the end of The Mandalorian. But then again, these may not have been the full-fledged Dark Troopers. They didn't even call them that. They called them assassin droids here. But
right.
we know what they became. But that being said, I mean, I do remember scenes from the novels that you're leading to that in the chronology predate this, where he demonstrated his abilities in hand-to-hand combat, you know, with sparring with Arlani, you know, for mm-hmm. for instance. So
right.
he does have those skills. But again,
he's a warrior.
We've also talked about that. Yeah, the Thrawn in Rebels is not exactly the same guys that showed up in the novels. So
mm-hmm.
There's a little bit of a disconnect. I don't know that it's that big a deal, but still, I did not remember him just beating down those assassin droids so handily.
Yeah.
You know, the first time I saw this.
Right. Yeah. You almost wonder if he had a more like in a different training mode kind of a thing, because he even had the safe code was Rook, which I thought was really cool mm-hmm. because, you know, Rook was his bodyguard in Legends. And he shows up later actually too, but I thought that was really cool. And then he tries to use that. It's almost like a safe word, you know, again, and then he couldn't get them to shut down because Kallus had reprogrammed them. So I wonder if they had a training mode on them is what I'm getting at, but who knows?
Well, and we've seen other versions of these droids on Kamino when they're training the clone troopers They weren't always lethal either. We saw them also in the Bad Batch. They showed up mm-hmm. a time or two as well. A lot of different versions of these droids. It's not entirely clear what version Thrawn had. They look no less dangerous, but...
Oh, for sure.
still, I wouldn't be punching a droid, you know, something made out of metal with my bare fists, so...
Exactly. Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, Obi-Wan kicked Grievous in the leg and you see him go, ah! oh, you have that.
and then, of course... He really gets to show how good he is at hand-to-hand combat after Kallus had reprogrammed those two droids mm-hmm. to go in and fight him. And he unleashed on them and ended up blasting each one of them several times right in the chest with a blaster that he had. So mm-hmm. quite dangerous there. Did you get a look at all of the things that were in Thrawn's quarters, all of his mementos?
Not until I watched Rebels Recon and was reminded of all of them. The main one that stuck out to me was Harris Kalikori. Yeah. And then there was also the Salamari in the background, you know, that we always associate with the Legends Thrawn mm-hmm. that he always had with him. But other than that, I didn't realize what all was there. So you want to run them down?
Well, sure. But we'll start off with those Salamari. I mean, I remember when this episode came out and we saw those in the background, there was so much speculation that we were going to see those things show up at some point in Rebels. And of course, they never did, so spoiler alert. But still, it was a nice nod to Timothy Zahn's work. But we get the Holy Grail from Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade.
Yeah.
I absolutely love those little crossovers they do between Star Wars and Indiana Jones. Mm-hmm. But in addition to the Holy Grail, there was an old lightsaber, which was really kind of hard to see, and I couldn't tell who, if anyone, it belonged to. There was a set of pan pipes. There was a clone commander's helmet that had markings similar to Commander Gree, who got decapitated by Yoda in Revenge of the Sith. So
that is super cool.
yeah. There was a bust of an Ebonetto, which was the alien species that was debuted in The Force Awakens.
L-O-F-E, yes.
Yeah, and then there was a Ralph McQuarrie drawing of what would become Lothal for Rebels. So a lot of cool things hanging out there in the background, as well as some mm-hmm. graffiti that Sabine had done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I thought it was cool in Rebels Recon how they said that that was the first time that they'd ever used an actual Ralph McQuarrie piece of art in the renderings, that they didn't change it in any way. So I thought that was a fun piece of trivia.
Yeah, indeed. But we've talked a lot over the past two seasons when it comes to Thrawn, his deductive skills and his logic skills and, you know, his study of art and how it helps him anticipate his enemies and things like that. And I've frequently expressed some disbelief and some doubt in those abilities. That being said, I really liked the way it worked out in this episode when he was analyzing the helmet that Ezra had been wearing and then compared it to Sabine's artwork that he had samples of, which led him to the conclusion that, you know, this bounty hunter that they had apprehended was in fact Ezra, and therefore if Kallus had been meeting with this person, then it must be Kallus that was a traitor. That was an impressive bit of writing. I think it's just kind of, when it comes to Thrawn, it's hard to do things that seem plausible when he's using those skills, but this was an exception. This was really good.
I agree. And it makes so much sense for Thrawn that he would be able to do that. And picking up on the colorization, the angles of the lines. I mean, he was really going in, you know, full detail on that. And I applaud that, because that's the Thrawn that I love. You know, the deduction, that savvy, that ability to, you know, be that strategist that we've always seen throughout the novels, throughout. And so this is a consistent Thrawn in that way, which I just love that.
Yeah. I kind of do wish that they managed to find a way to get the Kallikori back for Hera, because,
yes.
I mean, she lost that several episodes ago, and then she's been absent quite a bit in recent episodes. She's either had a bit role or she hasn't appeared at all in a lot of these episodes. So it'll be good to get some more episodes that feature her going forward.
And we will eventually.
Indeed. Well, we've covered the big plot lines here. Of course, Ezra and Kanan, Rex and the droids get away, and then Kallus has used all the confusion around List and his opportunity to swap the code cylinders back, and then List's attack on Price to give himself cover. Of course, he doesn't realize that they figured him out in all of this, so that he, you know, he stays behind so he can continue to act in this role as Fulcrum. But with all that, you know, do you have any other thing else that stood out to this episode that we should discuss before we wrap it up?
Well, I realized that List had to be the fall guy for this, you know, and all of the plot and whatnot, but it is just, I guess, a little, I don't know if I want to say unsettling, but just the fact that he was so unaware is the easiest and most polite way that I could put that, and so gullible and so easily manipulated. But I mean, I guess I could reconcile that with the idea that he was kind of bowing down in some ways to Kallus as almost like his superior.
Yeah.
And this ISB agent, which is a lot more, you know, maybe more inclined to see between the lines than he is, but he seemed really naive to me, like almost too naive for an Imperial officer. But I get it. It was there for the plot line.
Right. And of course, he's the same officer that Leia took advantage of back at the beginning of season 2.
Oh yeah. They mentioned that princess from Alderaan. Yes. Yeah. Yes. That was a nice little, not throwaway line, but you know what I mean?
Well, I'm a little surprised they didn't lean into that a little bit more with the framing of List here, that, you know, hey, you remember when those Alderaanian cruisers were abducted, you know, were stolen by the rebellion? List was around then too. So
that's true. Mm-hmm. Yep,
yeah, yep. Yeah, they could have done it, and maybe they just couldn't figure out a way to work that back into the script, which that happens, but
it does. Right. Well, I do have one question for you though. Would you have liked to have seen this episode completely from a first person perspective, almost like playing, you know, first person video game kind of a thing? Or are you glad that they decided to scrap that idea, you know, for lack of anything else, but that they didn't have all the assets for it? So how would you have felt about it being in first person?
It could have worked, but I really like the way it turned out this way. And it was kind of a neat introduction for the episode, with Kallus seeing all these things going on, and they're getting ready to make this apprehension of this ship, and then he, you know, he turns on the faucet and then he sees himself in the mirror. That was a neat thing, and so it's just kind of like this perspective thing that they were building up for us. But when you're not in control of the first person's perspective type of a thing for long, I think that might have been a little unsettling for the viewer. But what did you think?
No, I'm glad that they went the way that they did too, because sometimes first person can be, as you said, I guess unsettling is a good word, but you know, the whole motion that's behind it and just not being able to see peripheral vision. And then there were other things too that made sense that he wouldn't have been around for, you know, different scenes, like being able to see Thrawn fighting these assassin droids, you know, on his own, in his own time. You know, that's something that we needed to see from a third person perspective. So, you know, could it have gone back and forth a little bit more? I mean, I guess I would have liked that, you know, and maybe not the entire episode doing that, but I did think it was funny how they were saying, you know, they wanted it to be, I think it was Dave Filoni that said that he was just waking up, so there was no way to really put him in the asset of pajamas.
Yeah.
And so then they were reminiscing about, okay, so who have we seen in pajamas? Well, we've seen Dooku in pajamas, which is amazing. And and then we've seen Ezra kind of in some bed clothing as well. But so I giggled at that. I just thought that was fun.
Yeah, and of course the difference is that Dooku in his pajamas was during a much bigger scene and right. for longer part of an episode versus, you know, it was seconds is what we would have seen Kallus in that type of attire for the beginning of this episode. So I can see why they didn't go that route.
Yep.
All right then. Well then, I think that'll bring us to the end of our discussion of Through Imperial Eyes. We thank you all for listening to our discussion and we hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, please make sure to subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher choice. Also like to remind you that you can find all episodes of the podcast over on RetroZap.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune and Star Trek. As always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star rating and review on your podcatcher of choice, especially when that podcatcher is Apple Podcasts. Don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. And speaking of which, Jay, can you remind everybody where they can find all of our various outlets across the internet?
Sure, and you don't even need a code cylinder to do it. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And you can also check out all of our Pinterest boards and our YouTube channel, which has some unboxing videos as well as all of our past episodes. And you can join us over on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server for some real-time chatter. And if you want to do that, just go to our show page and click on our community tab, and you are there. So we are just one of a lot of different rooms over there on the server. All the shows have their own rooms, and there's also a lot of other great dedicated rooms to some other things as well. So check that out. And then we also have a TeePublic store, and our address is teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you can pick up all kinds of different fun apparel and home goods. So if you need a refresh on your spring wardrobe, you can find all kinds of things over there. We have 7 different show logo designs to pick from. And, you know, maybe you need a new water bottle or some stickers or some magnets for your fridge, head on over there and you'll find it all there. So with that, Dennis, why don't you let everybody know what you've got going on with Warp Trails right now?
Right. So Warp Trails is the podcast that my wife Beth and I do that is devoted to Star Trek. More specifically, we've been covering all of the new Star Trek content over on Paramount Plus. So that includes the first 4 seasons of Discovery, the first two seasons of Lower Decks and Picard, and the upcoming season of Strange New Worlds. So if you are a Star Trek fan like us, head over to the RetroZap podcast feed and check those out. Jay, what's going on in the world of cosplay?
Well, as usual, you can catch me up to all kinds of trouble over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay. So right now, mainly posting as Ahsoka, but you will definitely be seeing Hera very soon. So Dennis, you were just saying we need to see more of Hera. Well, you're going to get to see mine very soon. And I've been posting quite a few work in progress or WIPs in my story and also in my feed. So that'll be done here by the end of April. So I'll be having all kinds of new photos and whatnot up over there. And I was also on a recent episode of Coffee with Kenobi as well. So if you want to catch the top 5 things that Return of the Jedi taught us, you can catch myself and Greg from Ion Canon over there joining Dan.
All right, then. That'll do it for episode 398 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for joining us, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.